Right. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Thank you for tuning in into our session. Today we have a great session. Today we have the session on nature-based solution for improving soil health and water security. I thank you for being there. My name is Chani St. Martin. I am an international specialist in water and soil management. And I also want to thank you for actually tuning in both in physical and also virtual to our pavilion here. We are currently at the Pavilion of the Sustainable Agriculture for the Americas, which is being hosted by ICA on behalf of 34 member states. And it was also sponsored by the public and private organization. So I welcome you so much to this session today, which I think is very important here. I have here with me three panelists, very esteemed panelists, that I think will give much thought and spirit to what we are trying to do with the pavilion, which is really have a one voice approach in terms of the Americas, both Latin America and the Caribbean, as it deals with issues of climate or the nexus of climate and agriculture here. And more so, what are the lessons learned and how are we going to move forward for that one voice approach here? And so before I go into the panel and introduce the panel here, we have from different parts of the Caribbean here. I really wanted to, again, state the importance of such an initiative and how we go forward on it. And I wanted to introduce from right next to me, Dr. Victoriano Pascual, who is the Chief Agriculture Officer in the Ministry of Agriculture, Food Security, and Enterprise from Belize. Could we give him a round of applause, Jess? And thank you very much. I also have with me Ms. Donette Chalry. She is an economist in the development She is the Department of Economic Development, and she's from St. Lucia. Again, give her a round of applause, please. And I have Mr. Crispin Dovey, who is the coordinator of the program in the climate change and disaster risk management from the Organization of the Eastern. Thank you very much. Eastern States. So, colleague, I thought before we went into the discussion, perhaps what we could do is just show a short video and bring the real recent thing that these, what we're actually talking here is not just about talk, but the implications of it are far reaching. And so I wanted, if we could queue up the video to show something that occurred probably between 2 days ago that we saw in Dominica with the rains that we had here. So as I wait on the support staff to queue up the video, so we see the issue of this here, I would want to, are we ready? Video? Thank you. So I want us to take a picture of this here. Yes, no, that's fine, Donna, that's fine.
Yesterday we had heavy rainfalls that lasted for over 4 hours in Dominica on the eastern coast, which affected us greatly. As you can see here, we have had some major landslides in the area. And because of the topography of this area, we have been experiencing a number of major landslides. And these landslides have been destroying our crops, causing damage to our homes. And even yesterday, we experienced one of the community members who perished due to the landslide. The current situation we are facing in the Pacific Area with the Vector Head program is that
we could probably stop it here.
as you can see right there.
Right, so Donnett, you can have your seat. Thank you for engagement.
This is the current situation that we are.
So colleagues, I wanted to start off with this video here, mainly to bring up the point that it is not just the speak or the words that we are going to say there, but the action as to where do we go from here. So I wanted to start off the discussion with Dr. Pascual and to basically say, now that you're seeing this here, what really is the nature-based solutions and why is it important in a circumstance like that?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Good evening to everyone here. And I hope that you will have a very good, informative discussion along with us. But before I start answering the question, Chair, I want to inform, and I think, I'm not sure if most of you in here know, Belize, which is my country, was affected by Hurricane Lisa about a week ago, right? The city in itself was damaged, heavily damaged, and efforts to start clean up and build back better is ongoing. As it relates to our agriculture sector, we still have preliminary information and data, but the damages is upward of $7.5 million so far. And that's because the information is still coming in. And that's only one sector. So what we're seeing there is basically happening in several areas. The DR experienced something similar a while ago. So it's something within the entire region, and that's why the discussion of nature-based solution is very, very important. And it needs to be put at the forefront. But to put it in perspective, Chair, we need to understand that population is increasing, right? We know that. World population is currently about 7.9 billion right now. By 2050, it should be approximately 9.8 billion. So we know that put a strain whenever we talk about our population and our food resources. It does put a strain as it relates to our soil, what we're talking about, and also water. These are two resources that is required primarily for us to produce our food, technically. And with the discussion of nature-based solution, it falls right within the realm of how we're going to integrate this entire system. Now, nature-based solution is nothing new. The terminology might be much newer, but the concept and the approaches of nature-based solution is basically nothing new. Whenever we talk about nature-based solution, we're looking at things like watershed management, integrated land management, agricultural best practices, water harvesting. So all of these approaches are part of the entire nature-based solution. And we're only talking there from one perspective. We have all the marine perspective as well. So it's a whole encompassing situation whereby if we put these into perspective and actually utilize and build our ecosystem using the proper methodology and practices, then I think that the system that we want to put in place will be much beneficial. The ecosystem will thrive. And at the same time, we'll be able to produce food and maintain the water resources, which is so beneficial for the moving forward of our agriculture sector.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pascual. I wanted to fast forward a bit and I wanted to go to Crispin, Mr. Crispin. I wanted to ask you, at least from the OECS level, what you have been seeing with nature-based solutions. Is there a scope for it, particularly in the example? Have you undertaken some projects that you could reference? What are your perspective on the use of nature-based in these kind of circumstances? Thanks.
Okay, I watched the video with interest, and good afternoon, everyone. I watched that little clip with interest. I didn't want, obviously, I couldn't pass judgment on, you know, on anyone, or, you know, and of course, I can't say for certain But one of the things I noticed was the kind of crop cover that was on the site. Okay, when you have shallow crops, like say, for example, say banana, shallow root crops like say like dashin and so on, especially on very steep slopes, unless you have other measures in place, you could be setting yourself up to make your location more prone to landslides. And I know St. Lucia, where I'm originally from and where I still live, we have seen some really tragic events following some heavy rainfall events where there's been significant loss of life, not to mention crops and so on. So that said, I think we need to just give consideration to one thing. Very recently, there have been a number of reports, and it's been happening over the years, but recently I saw a report, I'm trying to remember which one, from whom, that was saying that soils around the world have been severely depleted, and they've lost fertility. The soil life, the biota in the soil has been affected by the use of agrochemicals, excessive plowing, and so on. So these methods, and of course, you know, we've been applying a lot of artificial fertilizers, and these have been having an impact both on site and downstream in our riparian areas, in the coastal areas. So obviously, it is not an ideal situation. So if you're able to return to more nature-based approaches, mulching, you know, and so on, that is going to be something that will be beneficial. And I think we've seen that when we take these approaches. But to answer your question, one of the things that we've done, about 2 years ago, the OECS published a toolkit on nature-based solutions, you know, ecosystem-based adaptation, but also factoring social inclusion and gender equality. Because we know the realities in that at the community level, for example, you know, in people, different roles are played by different people, and sometimes we don't truly try to understand these roles and these interactions. So that toolkit, which is available online, by the way, it tries to propose some of the approaches for that. We're also currently working on coming up with a we're hoping to ink a deal and an agreement with another regional partner for an actual nature-based project in the next couple of months. But I can't say too much about that yet because the deal has not yet been inked. But so we're taking this seriously. And at the community level, what we've been doing, we're doing a lot of riverbank stabilization, for example, but planting tree crops, like community interventions in St. Lucia, Dominica, and so on, trying to, you know, to help farmers and you know, producers to take the proper approaches to help to protect their water supply, protect their soils, and still get a yield, as opposed to taking, you know, trying to go purely for the engineering solutions, for example, which don't always, you know, optimize soil, you know, and soil and water quality, soil health and water quality in the long term.
Thank you. I think what some of the examples you gave there are very ideal, and we definitely will come back to that. I wanted to move forward to perhaps Donnet here, and I wanted to tease you with a question about, you know, we are talking about the nature base, but one of the things that you always hear is the issue of, is it economical? What is the financial thing? And this has often been presented as a challenge to it in terms of the sustainability. So I was wondering whether you could comment on that, your perspective on the economics or the financial aspect of nature-based solutions.
Thank you, Chani. Okay. So before I begin, I would just like to start with the fact that in the past, development has been viewed as a trade-off between economic growth and natural resources. And that has been very evident in the devastating effects that the country goes through after a storm or a hurricane. In 2007, I remember St. Lucia being impacted by Hurricane Dean, and that caused approximately 63% loss in just our agricultural sector. In 2010, we had Hurricane Tomas, and we experienced a loss of about 43%. Now, you know, given our limited fiscal space, that can be very debilitating to our country. So we normally have to be going out looking for funds to try to build back better. And we have realized that a building back better Now we have to be taking into consideration nature-based solutions. And I want to draw a reference to several initiatives that we have ongoing. I need to read it. That's the thing, I don't want to get it wrong.
It's fine.
So we have the Northeast Coast and the Northeast and the Southeast Coast projects. So those projects are basically they basically entail reforestation, the rehabilitation of coastal zones, coastal zone management, and it's all, there's also an ecotourism aspect to that. And what we have realized is that this is one way of creating employment. We were recently impacted by the COVID-19, and we have realized how devastating that was on the economy. So those initiatives create employment. Well, other avenues of employment, it is cost effective and it is long lasting. So economically, this is the way that I believe that most countries, if not all countries, should be going. Thank you.
Thank you. I wanted to perhaps, particularly because you brought up the economics here, I wanted to fast forward, Dr. Pasquale, you could comment on that here. The issue of, I like the idea of the challenges and some of the success stories here, but I wondered if you could put it into perspective to give us an idea of something very tangible that you've seen working. And more so the poignant question here, whether we could do it with nature-based solutions alone to address some of these things. Any comments on that?
Yes, and again, Chair, as the colleagues mentioned, whenever you have degraded soil and contaminated water, it is difficult, and you as a soil scientist might know this, it is difficult to restore back your soil to the way it was after it has been deteriorated. And likewise with the water, it's basically the same. Once the water is contaminated and based on the different contaminants that contaminate these water, it can take a long time to get it back to a level whereby we can see microorganisms thriving, or whereby we can start utilizing these water for the purposes that we want it for. But can it be done, and how it will be done? That's the question you ask. In Belize, we have done several activities when it comes to nature-based solution. And to be brief first, in the sugar sector, where we have primarily up north, where we have sugarcane plantations, we've realized over time that the soils were not as productive as they used to be. So with the government of Belize, the Sugar Industry Research and Development Institute, the Cane Farmers Association, and the millers themselves came together and see or thought of ways we can improve soil quality. And what was done is that we had farmers' field school where we would use some of the degraded lands and utilize what we call, we will use different practices. For example, we have what we call mucuna and calavalia. These are some type of legumes that is planted to help to restore back the soil. At the same time, we use the EMs, the effective microorganism, to try to replenish and restore back the soil. But apart from that, without using much inorganic pesticides, whenever we have incidents of frog hoppers, we would use the biological control matarizium, which is a fungus as well, that will affect these frog hoppers. So in that perspective, it's all entwined within the ecosystem. The challenge with that though, is that it takes a longer time before you start seeing the actual effects. And that is some of the challenges that we've had with some of the farmer. You know, farmers are people who invest their money and they want to see the return because they don't know when the next disaster will strike. They don't know when the next pest will attack, when the disease will come, when the hurricane, when the drought. So as they invest, they want to see the immediate returns. And that is some of the challenges. But for those who stick with the program, then over the years, 2, 3, 4, 5 years, and even longer, then you start seeing that everything comes together as one ecosystem. The natural predators come in to prey on the others. The entire system start moving more cohesively, and there is less need for inorganic fertilizers. And at the same time, what we do is we continue teaching farmer the use of biofertilizers and biopesticides. And with that, we've seen some successes. If I can give another example, I'm not sure if...
Surely, I'll definitely come back to you for the examples. We all for examples here. But I wanted to fast forward. There's some key things that you mentioned there. And Mr. Crispin, I'll come right to you here. The several reasons, I like that you not only spoke about some of the advantages, but you did highlight something about the time aspect here. And I want to craft the question very specifically. It might be multi-layered, but I'm sure you could handle that. I wanted to simply ask the question, can the farmers wait in terms of using nature-based solutions to address the issue? That's the entire carving of it. But I wanted to connect it to a point that you said, Mr. Duvay, which is the issue of, you mentioned that you'll use it in EBA. And I wanted to see, if we look at the issue of can the farmer wait, and we also look at the issue of, are the farmers owning it in terms of implementing that there? Where does that leave us? What kind of solutions or what kind of answers to the person on the ground who has or are interested in that, that we could give? How can we approach that here? I hope that is not too much, Mr. Duvay.
No, I think though that you have an expert who's a practitioner in the field of agriculture. He's explained to you that farmers make their investments and they want to see returns. You don't know when the next hurricane is going to strike, because there's nothing worse than say having you're waiting to harvest your crop of nutmeg or cocoa, whatever it is, and then a hurricane strikes and you've lost everything. And if you've lost your trees, right, you have to wait another 5 years to get full productivity for production back, assuming you can get planting stock. So I think from an economic perspective, the farmers, I think it depends how you look at it. They can wait up to a point if they will get returns, at least in the short to medium term. In other words, saying zero for a year or two, it probably will not hack it, because they have to feed their families. They have to be able to maintain their farms and so on. So if for example, you have a situation where, let's just say, you're taking a particular approach, say integrated, an integrated nature-based approach, it has a slower delivery time. They may want to look at, for example, if they have other crops, let's just say, where they're able to harvest fairly quickly, then they may go with that, right? But to tell them to wait 3, 4, 5 years to see a tangible, it might be difficult. So I think there's scope sometimes for a mixed bag approach where you have different crops, right? And using different means so you can get some returns while you're waiting for some of your longer term benefits to kick in.
Thank you. Donata, I will come to you. And a simple question. Can you take nature-based solution to the bank? A farmer is interested on the premise of actually transforming the farm. Can you really take nature-based solution to the bank as an approach that you would like to propose to be funded by the bank? And if not, thinking through it, what may be the guiding principles or advice that you will give the farmer to do that?
Maybe not to well-established commercial banks, but we do have development banks which partner with international organizations, and they are able to work with farmers. They are able to work with persons in the agricultural industry. They probably provide loans at very, very, very low interest rates. And sometimes there are grants that are channeled through the development banks. Aside from that, there are a lot of organizations that are willing to provide grants However, this also comes at a, I would say, with a disadvantage. Sometimes to access those funds can be a very, very, very tedious and a very long process. So you probably have to stick it out. Sometimes you are able to get assistance from maybe government organizations that have well-established relationships with those international organizations, and it would be a bit easier for them to run those projects, programs at the community level.
Thank you. And definitely now is your chance, Dr. Pascual, to give that second example of a success story, a model that have been used. Thanks.
But to add to what Danette mentioned just now, indeed, she mentioned the development banks that does provide. In Belize, our development bank are, and even the credit unions that a lot of the farmers bank with, are going towards this type of sustainable approach, and going green, utilizing green practices, solar panels and things like that. So there are areas and there are development banks, credit unions and so forth that does move or are moving in this particular direction. And of course we know several of these development banks, they try, and even credit union, they try to access funding from the Green Climate Fund and other projects. So they are moving in that direction. And at the same time, they are encouraging the farmers to move in that direction as well. But the problem that the question that was asked to Crispin, the mixed approach that he spoke about is something that some farmers are moving to. Especially some of the bigger cattle farmers in Belize, they realize and they have come to the realization that it's not just about cutting down the trees, because they notice that they have problems with water during the dry season. They notice that the grasses are impacted. So now what they're doing is trying to restore some of their land and using this agro silvopastoral system in a sense. So yes, his answer is quite correct. They need to, some of them are moving towards it because they cannot just fully move into it. As mentioned here, the farmers have mouth to feed, they have bills to pay, banks to pay back to. So the approach of slowly moving in is what I know a lot of them are doing. And another example I want to touch base on, Mr. Chair, is the Yaxche Conservation Trust. They are a conservation organization in the Maya Golan landscape in the southern part of Belize. Now, Yaxche work closely with the Ministry of Agriculture and other organizations to promote sustainable agriculture practices in this particular part of the country and within this landscape. They have primarily about 936 concession area that farmers use to grow their actual produce. Now, what is practiced in there is sustainable agriculture. The area was used for logging in the past, and there was significant destruction. The water was being polluted, the trees were being cut down, the habitat of the animals were being destroyed. So what happened, the conservation group got together and collaborated with the communities around and with the Ministry of Agriculture and others, and they started promoting three basic activities. Inga alley cropping, which Inga is a legume tree that grows, and they would plant in between these legumes. Cacao and agroforestry. We know that cacao trees can tolerate shade. So they would have these cacao trees and plant mahogany trees and cedar trees and others within. And also the use of apiculture within this forested area. So once the environment start taking shape, they realize that the animals starting coming back in, right? The bees production of honey started to increase. The waterways starting to get better. And it has been, I think they started this quite a while now, and the area has been reforested. Production has been booming. At one time, you couldn't see any scarlet macaws. Now you go back there, there's tons of scarlet macaws. So these are the things that nature-based solutions bring, and these sustainable practices. There is no use of chemical fertilizer there. Again, what is done is the use of biofertilizers. And as I mentioned before, it requires environmental education. It requires capacity building, because it does take a time to transition. It doesn't happen overnight.
I think that point of time is very clear. And before we go to the audience for some question in here, I would like to perhaps just two more questions before we go. Yes, I'm looking at you, Mr. Dubey. I want to go to the issue of scaling up. In terms of, he mentioned a model here and he was inching along that line. The question is, if we are going to scale up, do you have any examples of initiatives like that? Or perhaps, do you have a perspective on how do we scale up? How do we bring that to scale, or the replicability that is needed to have that kind of impact that we are speaking about? And since you're on the mic one time, I always give you the complex one. While we're thinking of the scale up and the replicability, what about the mainstreaming? How do we go forward and create that mainstreaming that is necessary for things like nature-based solution? And you will start off, but definitely you will get the assistance of the panelists or the contributions of the panelists to add on that. So again, the question is the scale up. How do we scale up that? Do you have any examples or at least any thoughts on how that could be done?
Okay, I'll say this much. I think for me, mainstreaming and scaling up are virtually the same, okay? I believe that for one thing, success breeds success. If you have 10 farmers and say three farmers try an approach that gradually shows results and you can see tangible and significant results, the others will most likely want to copy, okay? That I think is one of the key things to upscaling and to mainstreaming. Because when people see an approach, a different approach is working, they will want to adopt it. Okay, and that's one. I think for you to achieve both the mainstreaming and upscaling, I think you have to look at you have to look at a number of factors. I think there is a need, for example, for along the chain, the value chain and so on, there has to be the capacity, there has to be the understanding. So you need to work with your financial institutions, for example. So if you want to, if you're trying to take a different approach, a nature-based solution approach, for example, or a nature-based approach, you may want to start, for example, pivoting it as organic farming, for example. Sometimes you can get, it's the labeling, right? How you get it done. Because sometimes your product might not be the cheapest, but if you can see that it is a niche product, you add in significant value, or you have, you're able to leverage it, you can probably get away with that, right? And it's a entry. You have to sensitize your farmers. You have to work with your farming community, because sometimes when people have been doing things the same way for generations, sometimes, or they've forgotten some of the good practices, sometimes it can be good, it can be difficult to bring them back. Okay, so your financial, your practitioners, your people in your agricultural divisions and so on to really get them, to keep on pushing the work. Because people have been talking soil conservation and water conservation for years, but sometimes you have a break in continuity, and then maybe there's a de-emphasis and then people start to forget. So it has to be continuity. And of course you have to be pushing this in the schools and everywhere, all angles. In terms of mainstreaming, one of the things I think we've seen in the Eastern Caribbean, again, using St. Lucia as an example, and I'm not talking so much soils as a nature, not terrestrial as much as marine. Two things. First, your marine protected areas, for example, the Sufra Marine Management Area in St. Lucia was a very early example of how you could manage an area to help to, multi-use area actually, to help to ensure that, you know, by protecting certain areas, you're able to ensure the regeneration of, you know, the of fish stocks that can sustain an industry. Another example is the growth over the years. And I hate to say it, but I'm old enough to remember when the CMOS industry started in St. Lucia, right? To see it growing, I was actually in the division, in the fisheries division when it started. And it has boomed. Recently, for a long time, it was like, you know, like almost like a sleeper, you know, this activity. But now it has boomed to the extent it's being exported. They're doing new products, right? And it is very, very much nature-based because you're not using, for example, the agro inputs and so on. It's, you know, it's still at a, being done at a community level. And so it's people are benefiting directly from this. So it's not mass monocultural. Well, it is a monoculture in a sense, but it's not, you know, the pesticides and the, you know, the heavy tilling and so on. And I think there are lessons that can actually be transferred to land. All right. So I just wanted to just see this as an example, and it's spread to some of the Caribbean islands as well.
Thank you. Thank you. Donald, do you want to weigh in on that or do you want us to go? Thank you. Go ahead.
Oh, no. We can go ahead with the questions.
All right. Do we have anyone in the audience with a question?
Thank you. Thank you, colleagues, for the discussion. And I think you did a very good job in expounding the major issues, you know, that for consideration. I think I'll direct my question to Crispin. I know he's been around for a while. Well, you're making reference to age, so we go back in age. Crispin, I think my question is more on perspective. And we see the concepts and the terminologies coming around, like ecosystem-based, nature-based, and before that you had grassroots, and whole, we just see constantly the emergence of concepts. Based on your experience, do you see the requirements that comes with changing the mindset, changing what we do, coming with the emergence of these new terminologies, trying to guide what we're doing? What's your perspective on that from your own personal view?
I'll tell you something. I think it's a good question because, mind you, some of these terminologies have been around for a while, okay? And we've tended to push certain concepts like agroforestry. I mean, that's a term we've used over the years, right? Intercropping, we've talked about all of these things. I think one of the bigger issues has not been so much that, it's not so much the concepts or the terminologies. I think sometimes it's the institutional and political will to really push and to do the groundwork it takes to realize these things. Okay, so very often you hear the buzzwords, we must intercrop and so on, but are we really, really going from taking an A to Z approach, the education, the empirical analysis to show that Kurt Dillies is growing, taking this approach to his production, to his, you know, to his farming, right? Donet is taking approach B. What is the comparison? Is his yield is 50% more? Is it 25% more? Okay, and based on this, if you do this, you'll get that. I think a lot of the times, it is just based on, you know, it's anecdotal as opposed to taking an empirical approach and demonstrating to people, right, that this farmer in, you know, in Dominica is taking this approach and this is his yield as opposed to the person in Grenada who is doing that and, you know, and not getting a similar yield. So I think we need to do that. It helps to convince people. And I think also there's also the need in some cases to break down the terminology to say exactly what you mean, and so people fully understand, get the picture. Okay, but I think it's really a question of putting the resources where the talk is to deliver and to get these things going. And also when farmers take these approaches or producers take these approaches to make sure that the markets are ready, okay? If there's surplus, how do you export it to who, where does it go to? Is there scope for processing? I think there's still too many breaks in the chain, generally in food production, generally and distribution and nature-based or otherwise, whatever it is, I think there are too many breaks in the chain in too many instances. That would be my answer on that.
Thank you all very much, Margaret Ziegler with AICA. And I have a question. Can you comment a little bit about, you know, perhaps shifting to nature-based solutions requires some cooperative effort, perhaps more changes in practices and actually additional labor or obviously additional finance training. What is the role of cooperatives in helping to shift to nature-based solution models? And can they be more self-sustaining in terms of financing and returns to farmer, rather than just always going from project to project? How can cooperatives participate, and how can everything they're doing be more self-generation for income?
I will expand a bit, and I'm not sure if, I naturally don't have a loud voice, so I'll try. So with our cooperatives, you find that cooperatives are more community-based. So they are customer-owned. So as a member of a cooperative, I have shares in that cooperative. So I would want to see that cooperative progress, succeed. So most of the initiatives that are implemented by cooperatives are supposed to be community driven. So it would be easier, and they have a more intimate relationship with the community. So if you default on a loan, I can just call you up. So it is, I won't say easier to implement those nature-based solutions through a cooperative rather than a bigger institution that's all about dollars and cents. So you as a member, you want to see that that cooperative progress to succeed. So you would, in my opinion, you would probably try not to default on a loan. If you are having issues, you can probably just go in and say, I'm not able to make a payment. So they are a bit more flexible. So in my opinion, in order for them to be successful with those nature-based solutions, I would target the cooperatives before I would target the commercial banks.
Do you want to comment on that, Dr. Bhaskar?
Yes, I just want to expand a little bit. But again, whenever we're talking about nature-based solution and the management of our resources, there is no silver bullet that can fix all the situations that we face with this as it relates to restoring our natural environment. We need a collaborative effort from all the major sectors and players to make sure that we can move forward and having this sustainable management practices, building on strengthening the water and soil resources. But what is also important is that we need, as Crispin mentioned, the data is something that is required so that we can have more tangible information out there. And at the same time, it varies from area to area, because a particular area might take a much longer time to be restored than another one. So there are several ways to look at it, but at the end, it needs a collaborative effort to ensure that this works.
Thank you. And definitely, I would want to get back to you on an issue of scale and mainstreaming. Any other questions in the audience? Right.
Yes, Carl Augustine, Forestry St. Lucia. You talk about the issue, like what Mr. Dovey mentioned earlier, the idea of we are speaking of scaling up and mainstreaming and so on. But remember, farmers are business people. So this is more like a statement than necessarily a question, something to just think about. If we ask farmers to do certain activities or plant certain crops, and they are unable to see the monetary benefit, either in the short or long term, then we actually facing an uphill battle, right? And then the second thing is when it comes to the investment that we could actually, where we could get the money to invest, just bear in mind that we have Jeff. A lot of the projects, those landscape projects, can actually be a vehicle for investment with farmers, with landowners, with land managers. So I think sometimes when we are crafting those projects and developing those projects, we have to bear that in mind, right? So probably less focus on nice flowery consultancies and probably invest a greater percentage of those project funding into direct benefits to those people on the landscape, right?
Just further, do you want to respond? And another comment just further on what we've been discussing is also the credit union movement within our region, which is a big financing mechanism for a lot of small enterprises and many, many farmers. And I think that's also integrating the credit unions into the environment agenda as much as possible so that they gain the knowledge, but also so that they become a vehicle for change as well. So that when you come with a loan, that is highlighted, you know, ensuring that you have enough water, that your practices that you're going to be undertaken and the crops you're going to integrate also reflect these values and these issues that we know are coming and we need to address in order to build resilience. So I think this was a really good panel, really opening up the discussion about many of these issues.
Thank you. Before you go, you have another question? Right, so definitely we'll get back here to it. I wanted to push it forward if there are no questions yet as we close off. I wanted to ask two questions here. I wanted to be a little philosophical here and ask the question, are there really nature-based solutions before they have been tested? So the term nature-based solutions, are there really solutions if we are still talking about when we are implementing such practices, we have to collect the data, we have to vet it, et cetera. So I want to put just that as a philosophical thing here as number one. And number two, I wanted the panel to comment on, is there or are there opportunities to brand our products as nature-based products and perhaps have that as a particular niche market and tie that into other elements such as carbon credits because of the practices, etc. You have the mic.
Okay, thanks. I don't hog the floor on that one, but a couple of things. I wanted to, first of all, I'm going to sound a little eclectic here, but first of all, one of the questions you asked about earlier on about whether nature solutions were the only approach or we could go exclusive nature. I think in some cases you may have situations where the environment is too degraded. You may in the short term may have to take some non-nature-based solutions, for example, using geotextiles to stabilize certain landscapes, especially in steep areas and so on. So you can't, in the short term, it might not be practical to go totally nature-based. So I just want to from especially when it comes to land stabilization and in steep areas, but just park that aside. But the other thing I wanted to mention now, and going the idea. I wanted to react to something that was said earlier, to that, the last two interventions. I think we have not, and to still answer your question, a lot of the solutions have worked. We know that they work. The point about data was not to collect to see if they work, but to quantify the differences, right? Okay, so that we can use as a selling point. So we know that good soil conservation works. Right, and it does increase yield and so on. It increases water quality, but to quantify. So if you can tell, Kurt, to use Kurt again, Dr. Diris, that hey, your water has 10% or 20% or 30% less sediment than Donet because of the practices that you use. That's what I'm talking about. Not to prove that it works. So we know some of the solutions they do work, many of them. But the point I also wanted to make is that there are a lot of when we think in nature based, we have to think broader than simply just the going organic and all that, which is good, and integrated pest management. I personally see using solar, for example, as part of a nature-based approach as well, if you do it right, okay? And I'm even integrating aquaponics and hydroponics if it's done right as part of your nature-based approach. I see nothing wrong with that. I think, and the point I was going to get to critically is that I know in a lot of our islands in the Caribbean, we have an aging farming community. Okay, our farmers are aging. If you're able to embrace IT, for example, you're able to roast photovoltaics and other things as a means, you know, of attracting younger people into the industry who can use their IT skills and other things, you know, where you have your apps on your telephone and everything you're able to use to keep track of your farming. That might be a help to induce people whose family have land that's lying idle to go into some kind of sustainable food production. So I just want to throw that out as a closing point. All right.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm sure that Dr. Pascual Donet, Dr. Pascual has to add something to that. Yeah, we'll take a short intervention.
I just wanted to add, based on what you mentioned about the sustainability, I think that is very, very important, especially whenever we are executing several projects. We know that a lot of projects shift their focus on these best practices. And what happens after the project is done? That's the question that was asked. I think what we need to keep on doing is building on the education awareness. We need to have the policy in place. We need to have the legislative reform. All these things will be part of what we need to ensure that this can be inculcated in what we want to do.
Thank you. Donet, I really want to ask you the question about the marketing, the simple question. Are there opportunities to really market the product as nature-based, and what comes with that?
Yes, there is. Let me give you an example. I'm not sure if Carl can draw reference to that. With recently we have been, I don't know how recent it has been, but there has been a bigger uptake or a bigger I'm not sure what the exact word is, but in smaller terms, we have been planting a lot more cocoa. And I do not know how economical you think this is, but we now have a market where we can produce chocolate at the hotels, Hotel Chocolat, and also at Jade Mountain. You can, as a guest, you can actually make your own chocolate. So there is opportunity. There is, to me, this is an area that has to be explored economically, financially. And we still have a lot more exploring to do.
Thank you. Any more questions on the floor? No.
One more. I think there's a facet of the question you asked that I would like to hear from the panel on. Any one of them may wonder. When you reference the issue of nature-based, what makes us know and that it constitutes a nature-based? And I think the first thing I want to hear about is who defines what is a nature-based solution? And I'm not speaking basically from a scientific point. We know there are certain countries based on influence and power who say, okay, this is the standard for this and that. And we, as particularly smaller developing nations, have to comply. If not, these are not considered. So the facet of this question I want to hear about is when you say, okay, we say nature-based, but who defined that as a nature-based? You know, and can you, at your own, based on your own circumstance, meet that? And if you can't meet it, something you proposing as something else, where does it fit into that vision defined by whoever? I just want your brief view on that.
Should I give it to one of the nature-based experts?
I think that was obviously a trick question for the afternoon now. And with 3 hours sleep from last night, having arrived last night, you know, if I sound incoherent, it's because I am. But you see, I mean, to pin down a hard definition now of nature-based, I mean, you know, there's always, but some of the principles I would think of. Okay, the approaches do minimal harm to the environment or actually enhance or maintain, deliberately enhance or maintain the environment, all right? Or the natural system. So mulching as opposed to chemical fertilizers, for example. That's the kind of principle, okay? Where you as much as for you disturbing you're deliberately going in to disturb the natural cycle and the natural systems as little as possible, or to use them to the benefit of your production. That is essentially, at least from an agricultural context, that is how I would define a nature-based approach in very, 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 very simplest terms. Okay. And so, I mean, the doer is the one, to some extent, is best placed to justify what they're doing. But I think they are pretty established principles, you know, of what nature-based is. Okay. And so example, nature-based tourism, instead of cutting down the trees and put hotels, okay, you're using the forest and forest products where people come in, they, you know, as the forestry people use, Carl might remember, there's something on the Bad Lil in St. Lucia. Take nothing but photographs, leave nothing but footsteps and kill nothing but time or something like that. So I don't remember what it is, right? But so as opposed to coming, cut the trees, right? Build a hotel, right? That kind of thing. So, and even if you are building a hotel to do, you can do it sustainably, you know, instead of removing all the you know, all the topsoil and so on and so on. Right. So, I mean, I don't want to belabor the point, but I think you get the idea.
let me, Dr. Pasquale, do you have anything to add to that as we wrap up?
No, I think Crispin said it all. Basically, the practices, the best practices that is actually incorporated in the fields will basically define what the nature-based solution are. Minimal degradation, minimal pollution, minimal disturbing of the ecosystem. So Crispin mentioned it all just now.
Right. So I'm going to take the privilege of asking the last question here. Right. I wanted to ask the question here. And we kept on inching on it here. You mentioned time. Can we have maladaptation with nature-based solution? I want to answer yes. Can we have, because we have been talking about it, is there an opportunity or is there a chance that we could that could result in maladaptation through the implementation of nature-based solution? I wanted to tease that there.
Okay, again, I'm not sure if that's actually a trick question. But whenever we're looking at nature-based solution, and the term nature-based is basically focusing on preserving, enhancing, making the practices beneficial to whatsoever is in that ecosystem. So the idea of maladaptation from my point of view might be minimal, but again, there is always the idea of what we would call production of certain commodities, activities that may actually disrupt the ecosystem in that particular way. But the entire term of nature-based and what it stands for, there is limited and minimal adaptation in my view.
Thank you, Crispin. I see you itching.
I think there is a possibility. And I'll tell you what, especially if it's, sometimes people have them, okay, just to use an example. You might have a watershed that's deforested. You want to restore it to, maintain the water and so on. Now, what there can be maladaptation if, for example, you choose the wrong tree species. For example, you come and plant an people think, okay, plant trees. You plant an exotic species, right? For example, like say a teak instead of a blue maho or something of the sort, because a teak is actually deciduous. It sheds its leaves, it's introduced, or if we don't reproduce the natural ecosystem properly. So in situations like that, you have to be very, very careful, or you can have maladaptation, and you can actually sometimes make a situation worse. But in principle, if you follow the true principles, and for example, you're trying to mimic the ecosystem, then it's the chances are minimal if you're properly guided.
Thank you. That almost sounds like your closing statement. And Donette, I would like you, as we close off, if any other thoughts that you want to share, closing remarks as we close off the panel.
I just want to add that in order for successful implementation, I believe that we need to educate the public and we need to get the community involved.
Thank you. Nice and sweet. And Dr. Pasquale, I'm expecting something even nice and sweeter.
Well, again, as what both my colleagues mentioned, education awareness is the key. if you're aware and if you're educated about how to maintain and preserve what we have, then there it is a big step forward. It's a positive step forward to ensure that we maintain what we have.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all those here. I would really like to thank the panelists, as well as the persons that would have been in the background preparing for this, both our climate team and also we see for sure the Commonwealth here, who have contributed a key partner in this particular event. I want to thank all persons who would have helped in preparing and executing this. And thank you very much, your audience. It was really a lovely sharing of the perspective. Thank you.